Yeah, I want to end this brief history on deep learning with a short video on the current research trends, things that became very popular in the last couple of years. So one thing that became very popular in the last couple of years was self-supervised learning. So last lecture I explained how self-supervised learning works in a nutshell. So essentially it's about leveraging unlabeled data where you create some artificial labels that you can then use for supervised learning, but this is really for data sets where you don't have labels for your target tasks. So you would come up with tasks like separating an image into individual parts and then predicting the neighboring parts of an image. So if you have the face of the cat and then an ear here, and you show the network only the face, the network should predict the prediction of the ear, whether it's here in the upper left corner, upper right corner, and so forth. And by that, you teach the network to understand better the object structure of or the cat, what a cat looks like. Another thing I saw recently or last year a lot was contrastive learning. So this is a form of self-supervised learning where you generate two versions of an image. So let's say you have an image of a house. That's maybe not a nice house, but you know what I mean. So it's a house like this. So you feed it to the network here. And then let's say you have the same house that is maybe squeezed or let's say rotated upside down. You have this house upside down and you feed it to this image, to this network. So it's the same network, but you feed the image one time in the original position and one in some augmented version. And then the network has to predict whether it's still the same object or not. And so that you train the network to recognize that this upside down house is indeed the same object. But then if you, let's say, give it something different, let's say you give it a cat image here or something like that, you give the cat image to the network, then it should predict that this is indeed different from the house. So you train the network to also better recognize objects. But here, notice you don't have class labels or something. You just create the labels yourself by augmenting this. So if you augment this by rotating it, you know it's still the same house. So in that way you created this label for free without having a human to label this data, because you can do this all algorithmically. Of course, this is not the target task. You're probably interested in something else, but this is usually useful for pre-training a network before you can fine-tune it to your target data set. It usually helps making a network better. But this is something that is beyond the scope of this course. It's more like an advanced topic or something that is more recent. We won't be using it in this course. It's like an optional topic. But if you're interested, there was a very beginner-friendly article by Jeremy Howard, which you can find here, where you can learn a little bit more about self-supervised learning. You can, of course, experiment with it in your class project if you like. Another recent research trend is the focus on graph neural networks for graph structured data. So traditionally, deep learning was focused on text data and image data, and nowadays also people work with graph neural networks if you have graph structured data. For example, personally I work with molecules also, like structures of small molecules, and you can also think of them as graphs where you have the atoms connected by the covalent bonds. You can think of it as a graph neural network. And this is a big topic, and also this would be a little bit out of the scope of this course, but I found a nice introduction to graph neural networks here if you are interested. There are so many papers, I don't want to pick a particular one, but I think this is an interesting or beginner-friendly introduction to the topic. So it's all kind of related to message passing also. So that would be another interesting thing. Also, a recent trend is the work on large-scale language models. So it started like in 2018, where people trained models with 94 million parameters, and then they scaled it up. You probably heard about GPT-2. It was, I think, in 2019. Now there's GPT-3 with 175 billion parameters. So language models become bigger and bigger and bigger. Of course, there are also some research approaches that focus on keeping things small, like DistilBERT. It's like a small version of BERT. So in that way, people also make smaller versions of existing models. But the trend is somehow going towards these bigger models. Of course, this is something that is really out of reach for most academic researchers. This is something you would do at a big company. I think, I forgot the exact numbers, but I think this model, just training it back then, cost like $500,000 or some crazy amount. So it's something you can only do if you if you work in a very big company. So anyways, so here's also an interesting or nice blog post summarizing the research highlights of 2020, focusing mostly on the natural language processing. This is where I also found this image, which I think is based on some other website. But this is also, if you're interested in these large-scale language models, it would be an interesting read for you. We will be covering actually some of these models at the end of this course when we talk about transformer models, because they are all based on the transformer architecture. And another trend also, recently read this paper here, was transformers in vision, where people now also adopt these transformer architectures to computer vision. So however, this is also really large scale. So here, for example, they say even like an image net, like 40 million images is not enough to train a vision transformer. So it's really something that is mostly out of reach for academic research. And also these transformer models, they may work very well on very, very, very large data sets, like 500 million images or something. However, for most applications, convolutional networks will still outperform them. There was also recently just a new architecture of convolutional networks. So the convolutional networks are still status quo. It's still what you would use in practice for computer vision. So it's nothing like, it's very experimental. It's nothing that is very close to being competitive with convolutional networks on common images, but I just I thought it was interesting and worth mentioning where things are going. All right, so in the next lecture we will talk about the perception algorithm in more detail, and we will have some code examples. In the lecture last week I mentioned the code examples may come later, but I think it's maybe really useful to introduce it rather sooner than later. So I have an ungraded homework exercise for you. You don't have to submit anything, it's just for yourself, so just to prepare yourself a little bit. So I already posted this on Canvas, but please really take a look at this as preparation for the following lectures. It's like an introduction to NumPy, Python and NumPy. So of course there won't be any questions in the homework or exam on NumPy really specifically, but it really will help you to understand how PyTorch works and how we implement code, because it's really like the linear algebra foundation here. If you have questions also about that, please let me know. So it's just like a brief review of NumPy. If you are already familiar with NumPy, you can also skip that. But I would just recommend taking a look at it and see whether it makes sense to you. If it's all new stuff, you may want to read through it more carefully. All right, then let me know if you have any questions. And then the next lecture on Thursday will be on the perceptron.